Okay, everyone, we're about to get started. So please take your seats. Really quick announcement again, don't forget to go sign up to lead a discussion group if you would like to do that. The easels are outside. And now we have some festive stickers to attach if you're interested in attending a discussion group so we can get a sense of how big they are. So feel free to apply those stickers. Okay, so we're gonna go ahead and start the final session, Tweaking the Chain. And our first presenter is Jeff Garzik, and he's going to be presenting about a bevy of block size proposals, 100, 102, and more.
Thanks a lot. I'm Jeff, I'm with Block, and we're gonna be talking about every single block size proposal that seemed worth talking about, not just mine. So let's get to it. This is going to be the least technical presentation at the conference. I'm not getting deep into any of the block size proposals, mainly covering the metrics. The block size, changing the block size itself is actually, pretty simple. You know, it's sort of, you change a constant. And so it's more a discussion of algorithms, rollout, et cetera. What are some of the high-level concerns with block size? Just summarizing, we've been actively addressing technical scaling issues, mempool, other work, that's been fantastic. But I think this has been deferring some of the economic and game theory issues, so that's not so good. Other high-level concerns and problems, sort of what I call the FOMC problem, is where humans pick block size and functionally you're choosing economics. Versus the free market, where the free market chooses block size, but maybe it chooses wrong and runs Bitcoin off a cliff. Centralization is on the low end and the high end. You have to sort of achieve a Zen balance where at the very low end, all the users are forced onto, you know, Coinbases and walled gardens, et cetera. Similarly, at the high end, most of the nodes can't process big blocks, et cetera, so you force a lot of nodes off the network and you centralize that way. And either end, you defeat the security and the privacy of the system. So how do you achieve that balance? What is a healthy fee market? We haven't really figured that out yet. Is the algorithm, the block size algorithm, easy to game? Can miners game it? Can users game it? Can you generate a lot of transactions, et cetera? There's very little field data on hard forks. We've had a couple incidents in the past, like the March 2013 fork incident, et cetera. And very, very, very early in Bitcoin's lifetime, there were some hard forking type changes. But in general, we have very little field data on hard forks in general, rolling them out to a large user populace. Signaling Bitcoin growth to external parties. A lot of people are looking at block size as sort of a proxy of can you upgrade Bitcoin, and by that, by extension, should I start to build a new project on top of Bitcoin? The predictability of the block size and the fee market from a user point of view, is it sort of chaotic? Is there going to be a crisis and then all of a sudden the block size changes? And, you know, users want predictability. High-level concerns, miners mining without validating. Just a note, miners, as relates to block size, today they can, you know, choose to reduce the block size. They can't choose to increase it, but they can choose to reduce it. That's the average block size over the past 2 years. It's going up, it's not racing up. That's the average over the past 180 days. It's not really going up very much. Thinking about the fee market. From a user experience standpoint, fees are very difficult to reason in Bitcoin. They're very difficult to predict by design. That's just how the system works. Fees are disconnected from transaction value because it's size-based. So you might have a very low-value transaction that's very big byte-size-wise, and as a result, you're paying a large fee on a very small volume transaction. Conversely, you might have a very large transaction value, $1 million worth of Bitcoin, and it's just one UTXO, so the fee is tiny. And so you boil that down, the user point of view, they really only have four choices in terms of what they get for what they pay. You can pay a high fee, and that's I want it as soon as possible. You can pay average fee, you can pay slightly below fee, or you can pay near zero and have a very long wait. So those are very vague definitions from the user point of view, and so they don't really have control directly based on fees. And furthermore, the block generation times are very noisy. You might have a burst of two blocks inside of a minute, and you might have to wait an hour for another block. And so even if you pay a high fee, you're not guaranteed that it'll confirm in the next 10 minutes. You just know it'll confirm in the next block. And so the user point of view, the user experience is that transaction fees are very difficult to reason. And that steps up into the wallet software, where wallets have a difficult time figuring out, number one, what's the best fee to pay? And there's some security issues related to that. And how do you present that in the user interface? So the fee market status, the changes, the economics, the market reaction, all that plays into block size as well. The fee market exists today in a narrow band based on simplistic wallet software fee behavior and some minor latency. And so if you think through some scenarios of block size changes, you think, okay, if we have full blocks and then we change the block size, that's basically going to reboot the fee market, introduce a lot of chaos into the user experience. If you have not full blocks and then a block size change, you don't have that hurdle. So a large block size step basically reboots the fee market. So with that background in mind, let's move on to BIP 100. And we have I been really talking for 23 minutes?
No, that's time remaining.
Oh, time remaining, thank you. Gave me a heart attack. I didn't know if I was time traveling or not. Okay, shift block size from devs to free market. That's the theme of BIP 100. And the summary is it floats between 1 and 32 megabytes. Those are the training wheels. You have to have a hard fork to move beyond that. This is a recent change. There is a default growth, this is taken from BIP 100.5, of 1.09% per diff period, which is 100% growth every 2.5 years. Basically, it's a slow motion miner vote. There's a continuous three month voting window. At each 2-week diff period, the new size looks at the last 3 months worth of Coinbases. And then you examine the 90th percentile of the votes and take the average. The limit may not increase or decrease more than 1.2x. And the activation method is flag day. You say this on this day in 6 months from now, that's when the network changes. Analysis. that shifts block size selection to the free market. It avoids anointing the devs as, you know, the Federal Open Market Committee, the guys who just, humans who pick constants. I think we need to move away from that. And miners have an input on fee income. Community feedback, it gives miners way too much control, they say. Miners can sell votes costlessly. And the limit increase is too large. That particular point was addressed. The miner control issue I'm gonna cover later. But basically, that's BIP 100 in a nutshell, and that's sort of the template for these other BIP proposals that I'm going to describe today. It's basically, I'm gonna give you, this is sort of my analysis, but what is the community feedback as well? Because that's quite relevant. BIP 101, the theme predictable growth. It's an immediate jump to 8 meg that doubles every 2 years. Activation is like BIP 34, it's a lock-in, 750 of the 1,000 blocks indicate support, it turns on. And then there's, after that point, there's a 2-week grace period. So it's predictable, that's good. From a user perspective, et cetera, et cetera. But there's no free market sensitivity. It may be way too big for what we need, or it may be way too small. And the fee market is significantly postponed. Since you have, as blocks are a limited resource and transaction fees are bidding for that limited resource, you wind up with, if you have, say, average 4 megabytes of traffic, maximum block size 8 megs, you're not going to have fee competition. And so fees stay low, similar to the current system. Community feedback, you know, it was a big size bump. It appears larger than the consensus, which is around like 2 megs or so. And there was negative community reaction to like Bitcoin XT and sort of politics, you know, wove into that. Community reaction, there were open letters tossed back and forth, drama, drama, drama. That's all I'll say about that. BIP 103, block size following technological growth. Increases the block size by 4.4% every 97 days, leading to 17.7% a year. Activation 1.5 years away to give the community time to prepare for the hard fork. It's predictable. No free market input. The fee market, a competitive fee market where blocks are full, appears sooner rather than later. There hasn't been a whole lot of community feedback. Correct me if I'm wrong. The main criticism was from the community that it was way too small an increase. And therefore, another hard fork would be likely to jump beyond that. And the 2017 activation way too far away. BIP 105. Consensus-based block time retargeting. It starts at 1 megabyte, and the miners vote to up or down the block size increase by a maximum 10%. Miners vote by providing, they basically pay with difficulty. They provide a proportionally larger block hash target. And so you either get lucky or you mine for a longer amount of time, and that's how you increase the block size. So there is a cost to the miner to increase the block size. Activation method not specified. Analysis, it shifts the block size selection to the free market and away from the devs. It avoids anointing devs as high priests, and miners have an input on fee income. Community feedback, there's been very little feedback. My personal opinion is that pay with difficulty skews the incentives, and it's difficult for miners to reason. Whereas, you know, if you have miner A and miner B, and one wants to increase the block size and the other doesn't, you know, miner A can work, and then miner B, he doesn't care, so he wins the block. So it's very difficult to game through effectively, and it's very difficult to reason. But I do think that there's a potential modification to this, which is very interesting. It's called pay to future miner. And that was one of the things that Minnie Rosenfeld proposed. And what that is you use check lock time verify to lock some funds, but you make it an anyone can spend. And so you're paying to whatever miner is a year in the future, 2 years in the future, 6 months in the future. BIP 106. Dynamically control max block size cap. There are two variants here. Variant number one, per difficulty period, it basically says if blocks are full, then 2x the block size. If blocks are less than 50% full 90% of the time, it halves the block size, otherwise no change. Variant number two, it's I encourage you to read the BIP because the formula is quite complex. But this is the actually interesting variant. It looks at transaction fee pressure. And if transaction fee pressure is increasing, then it increases the block size. And so that's pretty interesting. Analysis, you know, it shifts block size selection to the free market, avoids anointing high priestesses or priests. And community feedback, not a whole lot. Variant number one, it's very easily gamed. I'm not too impressed with it. It's very easy to just fill blocks with spam and pump the block size up. Variant number two, more interesting, but it does encode the economic idea of too much fee pressure. And so you're having the software decide, okay, we now have fees that are too high, so let's increase the block size. So that's an open question, needs analysis. Is it a good idea, is it not, et cetera. BIP 102. AKA the backup plan. One-time bump to 2 megabytes. The activation is a flag day, like 6 months in the future, with non-binding miner voting to signal that the hash power is ready for that type of upgrade. Analysis, intended as a backup option. It's conservative with regards to block size limit. It doesn't jump immediately to 4, 8, 32, et cetera. It's conservative with regards to the algorithm. It's just changing a constant. It's conservative with regards to obtaining hard fork field data. That's one of the things that we have an absolute, we're missing is all the things that we don't know, the unknown unknowns about a hard fork. This. Is this me? Okay. I didn't know if that was those guys over there. Okay. It's highly predictable. It's always 2 meg. 2 meg generally seems acceptable to most people, but it does not avoid the FOMC problem, and it requires another hard fork, potentially with all the contention, et cetera, to change again. Similarly, and Taj really nailed it with the BIP numbering here. I've got the exact same BIP numbering as Taj, and that was totally decentralized groupthink there. Out of back proposed 248, so we're calling that BIP 248, or I am, and apparently Taj is as well. 2 megabytes now, 4 megabytes in 2 years, 8 megabytes in 4 years. I presume that the activation is similar. It's a flag day with non-binding miner voting. Analysis very similar to BIP 102. Is it's conservative with regards to block size limit algorithm. It's highly predictable. It enables us to hard fork and learn, hard fork and receive field data, what goes wrong, what goes right, et cetera, similar to BIP 102. It does not avoid the FOMC problem. And again, like BIP 102, it requires another hard fork to move beyond that. BIP 000 is, again, Taj beat me on the BIP numbering there. That's essentially status quo. That's what we have today. Keep the current block size until change is obviously necessary. Keep the current block size limit. Keep the node count decline at current levels, et cetera. Analysis, it's maximally conservative. It's, what's been working today. It's going to be working tomorrow until the blocks are full. It goes against, unfortunately, the economic majority of Bitcoin businesses and miners. We can't really sample the users, but there is a clear economic consensus that they want to increase. There's not a clear economic consensus about target, but if you ask Bitcoin exchanges, businesses, miners, all those guys, they all want to increase. Once blocks are full, it's a radical change to a more adversarial zero-sum system. It's a radical change to the fee market, different economic policies completely. And wallet software is very poorly prepared. There's poor user experience. It's, again, difficult to reason for users, et cetera. This is what I call the fidelity problem. You have outside entities who are considering Bitcoin, considering rolling out projects, et cetera. But they look at the block size thing, they see people doing everything but increasing the block size. And they say, well, it doesn't appear to be growing. Why would I flip the on switch to my pilot program and instantly max out the 1 megabyte bandwidth? And sticking with the status quo, unfortunately, winds up with a crisis-based change. If you need to immediately increase the block size, you're doing it on short notice to the dev, short notice to the users, and no data has been gathered on moving on a hard fork until that crisis. And just like in politics elsewhere, policy making in a crisis is probably the worst policy making that you can do. Centralization on the low end, that was mentioned on the first slide, is if you stick at 1 meg, there's potentially users pushed into walled gardens and centralized systems as fee pressure increases. So recommendations, this is my personal thoughts. This is not speaking for anyone else except for myself. All vendor hats are off. I think we need a small bump now to gather crucial field data. You can theorize, you can test, you can simulate, but the internet is the best test lab in the world. The real world is the best test lab in the world. And you can only get that full accounting of field data, that full experience, if you actually do a hard fork. So the economic consensus definitely wants to push beyond 1 meg. The technical consensus is that going beyond 2 meg is a little bit too risky. I think that this is the do-nothing approach is sort of the worst of all the options. It's a very poor signaling to users, future users, the market. And giving the economic consensus, it seems likely to fracture Bitcoin itself. However, both the BIP000, the do-nothing, and all these BIPs, none of those resolve some key questions about transaction fees. Notably, you know, how much fee is too much? Who decides how much fee is too much? The BIP106 variant 2 had an answer to that one. But in general, people say we need a healthy fee market, but that's sort of where the description stops. You don't really drill down into what is a healthy fee market, what is a price that brings Bitcoin users onto the system rather than chase them off the system. And so those are sort of the existential questions that a lot of these block size proposals generate. I think in general, there's so much work outside of block size that is very, very positive that we've been successfully kicking the can down the road. We've integrated libSCCP 256K1 that increased validation speed. Validation cost along with cost of attack is basically the two key big metrics in our system. And so we've been making very, very positive strides in that. And that's reduced some of the pressure to change the block size. But nevertheless, I think that given the desires of the users and economic consensus, it seems likely that people want to go at least to, say, 1.5 megabytes, 2 megabytes, something like that. So that's a quick rundown of all the BIPs as they've been proposed. There have been a couple other BIPs. It seems like everybody has an idea about where block size should be, what the algorithm should be, et cetera. But the difficulty is in finding an algorithm that cannot be gamed, cannot be bought, and it's sensitive to the free market. And so that's almost a paradox. All of those check boxes is you can get like 2 out of 3, but you can never get all 3. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to you crazy kids for questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's start over here.
Hey, Jeff, that was a great presentation, so thank you. One question I have is a lot of times
I'll slip you $20 after the presentation for saying that.
My Bitcoin address is. typically when you're doing capacity modeling, or at least when I have in the past, it hasn't been done with average sizes. It's been done with 90% peak, or maybe in this case, because we're trying to figure out how long something might be delayed if you don't do it, maybe how many in a row are over a 75% peak or something like that in terms of the modeling. Have you taken any other looks at it rather than that average process? And is there any insights that you've gained from that?
I've definitely taken a look at that specifically for BIP 100 because that has been one of the sort of things to nail down is that once you have these miners voting, what do they vote on? What percentile do you take? Do you chop off the top and bottom? Do you take the most common floor? And I've done a couple simulations and the result was that average was suboptimal. And so that needs improvement. And percentile wise, it really didn't seem to matter beyond like 80th percentile or so. That was sort of lost in the noise above that. But beyond that, definitely need to sort of call out to the community for, and this is, I think, a key community need, is just more testing and simulation in general of not just my personal proposal, but any of these. I sort of see a dearth of testing and simulation that is absolutely required. Pick every single continent on Earth, do some testing on those. Pick every single major network provider, do some testing on those. Bring back that data. And I haven't seen any of that so far. Well, that's not true. There's a gentleman right there who's nodding who has done some, Rusty's done some numbers. But in general, we need much more data. So.
Hi. I have a question. What you said about the what fee is too much is a very good point. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on, say, maybe asking the question of what fee is too much could be in proxy answered by, if we assume that fees are pushed up by people using Bitcoin for useful things they want to use it for, then could we maybe use number of people? Or no, I don't know how you would measure users, but I think that's a little bit more viable than measuring a fee number or fee level. What do you think about that and pros and cons of that?
Yeah, that's definitely one of the sort of inputs into the whole block size debate, but it's very, very difficult to measure users. And so that's why in BIP 100, for example, miner voting was chosen as a proxy for that. If you want to directly measure users, are you measuring stake? And so you advantage, you know, the 20 big vaults and rich people who hold a lot of Bitcoin. Are you measuring transactions? Are you voting in each transaction? Well, that's very easy to game. It's very easy for me to generate 50 transactions, all of which vote a certain way. And so measuring users is the best thing. That would be the ideal, but how do you do that? And so that's really the challenge in that. In terms of what is too high a fee, you know, one of the big questions, or one of the questions I take with that is, what do the miners think about their income now? Does it produce a sustainable, secure system in the future, et cetera? You know, in the past, miners have made the choice that we would rather onboard Bitcoin users and have very low fees than have high fees at such an early stage in Bitcoin's life. And so that's a valid economic choice as well. But if you make that economic choice, then do you ever stop subsidizing fees? What's that, you know, what's the point in the future where we say, okay, we've onboarded the users, now we need to get to a healthy fee level? And so that's really a sort of miner income question, economic question that no one's really done a good job of answering.
So question from IRC is, given the existence of non-bandwidth scaling solutions, i.e. not just on-chain scaling solutions, should we prefer bandwidth solutions over non-bandwidth ones?
Both. I mean, that's the simple answer, is we've been doing a lot of scaling work unrelated to block size, and that absolutely needs to continue. But at the same time, you have very promising technologies which don't exist. It's a big risk whether they will be highly effective or not. And the original vision of Bitcoin was peer-to-peer decentralized cash. And so once you start moving up to layer two, layer three, et cetera, you can address some of those questions, but at the same time, the core system bandwidth hasn't changed.
I think the lack of consensus right now boils down to the problem that miners think they need to choose one BIP over another. I think it will be very easy to find a consensus if miners could vote for several proposals that they approve to. So the point will be that just as informative vote, where they can, for example, say, I'm okay with BIP 100, I'm okay with BIP 102, and if one of those reach some threshold, then we can start talking about doing the hard fork. What do you think about that?
Yeah, that's actually related to some of the rollout proposals. Specifically, when in Montreal, we were sort of noodling, how would you roll out a hard fork? And you definitely want to engage the users, know that the users are going to upgrade. And so a flag day, pick X day, say 6 months in the future, was the preferred solution. But you really want a non-binding, like you just described, miner vote to say the hash power is ready for that hard fork. And so there's sort of two leaves to that rollout. And definitely it makes a lot of sense to have the hash power say, you know, we support this proposal, this proposal, this proposal.
Yep. So there's been a few questions on IRC about looking for comments on the segregated witness stuff.
It's totally cool, and I totally missed the talk.
It's a little red button on the bottom of the mic.
Quick comment, it's not really a question, sorry. I have a bunch of hard fork data, a few gigabytes of debug log files. I haven't had time to fully analyze it, so if anybody wants to help with that, come talk to me, it's available.
Yeah, make it public somewhere, we can all work on it.
Yeah, I'll make a torrent and publish it on Reddit sometime when I get time, but if you want to talk to me beforehand, I can give you URLs, I just don't want to publish the URLs because it'll knock down our servers.
Next IRC question is, how do you expect we'll arrive at consensus?
That's the question of the hour, and I think that it's more of a process whereby, you know, in Montreal, we sort of did the input data stage. In Hong Kong, now we're sort of looking at, okay, here are all the issues, the validation costs, the various block proposals, et cetera. And now the step three is you take that back, you noodle with the users, the businesses, the miners, and you come up with a rough consensus. How do you do that? My general response, which some people dislike, is that you need to make your thoughts known in public. And so everyone can know that, you know, this is what, you know, Jeff Garzik thinks, or this is what BitPay thinks, or something like that. And I think that transparency and discussion are the ways that we find that. I think that, you know, backroom deals, going, you know, private visits to various people, that's not the way you do it. You have to do it in public. That's the open source way. Thank you. All right, do you have more questions?
I actually have a question. So what's preventing us from moving to 2 megabyte block sizes tomorrow?
Well, a lot of factors. There is still resistance to change in general. There's the valid concern of hard fork risks splitting the community. There's lack of testing. There's lack of patches. Which I'm pushing today to address that minor bullet point. But in general, there's been a lot of work not on block size, and so moving to it tomorrow would just not work. And so I think that, you know, all of us in this room need to work towards, again, you know, test, simulation, generate data, generate patches. You know, it's not a magic formula, it's just a lot of hard work. Yeah, I mean, that's reasonable. 1 month is reasonable, but basically, you're going to be rolling out a patch, but that patch is going to say, okay, 6 months in the future, we're going to do X. And so you have 6 months worth of time, 6 months of buffer to do additional testing, simulation, et cetera.
Hey, Jeff, thanks for the presentation. So in one of those slides, you had still a 75% level, so 750 out of 1,000 blocks.
That was BIP 101.
Okay, so what is your optimal choice for that type of for system? Is it 75%? Is it 80, 90?
That's why we're leaning towards flag day with non-binding miner voting, is to avoid picking a specific number. You just want to have minor consensus. You want to have the clear majority of hash power hashing on the fork that users are validating, that users are preferring. And so I don't want to pick a number. I don't have a number. It's basically just a supermajority of the hash power, but that's step two. Step one is the users agree by running the new software.
Would you break SPV clients for the hard fork?
Potentially, if that's what needs to be done.
Well, no, you don't have to do it, but would you do it deliberately?
No. No, absolutely not. I don't want to break any user deliberately. You know, I want to maintain backwards compatibility if at all possible. But not all wallets are even SPV. Some are sort of SPV light.
Do you think that increasing on-chain bandwidth can interfere with the value of Bitcoin?
I think it will increase the value of Bitcoin. It will bring on more users. It will signal that we're willing to grow, that we're willing to change, that we're willing to enhance the system. And I think that not increasing the block size is a signal that we're being stubborn. We are turning away people. We want to increase fees and push people off the system. But obviously, that's a contentious opinion.
Okay, let's get up to Jeff. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, our next presenter is Mark Friedenbach, and it's a flexible limit trading subsidy for larger blocks.
So I really want to thank Jeff Garzik for that excellent talk, especially the conclusion slides. Who picks what fee determines what block size is the question, and that's what I hope to answer today. My talk is going to be about a category of dynamic block size proposals that attach the block size limit to the fee market in such a way that as there is more demand for block space through users willing to pay fees, the block size will automatically increase or decrease as necessary. So just a little bit of course, requirements here. Why is this a big concern? Because we need the block size limit to increase in order to support more users. Even with off-chain scaling solutions like Lightning, it's obvious that 1 megabyte is not going to be enough well into the future. So a payment network which is stuck at too small of a block size is useless. You can't bring users on board. It is not going to be able to fix our needs in the future. But at the same time, a block size that is too large leads to direct mining centralization that not only in an adversarial case where miners are out to get us, which thankfully is not today, not only is that an issue, but also we might see centralization to just one miner or one group of miners all located in one place. And that's large block size have that effect. So we're really looking here for the Goldilocks zone where the blocks are large enough that they're able to onboard at least enough users for Bitcoin to be successful, but not so large as it destroys the entire network. So a lot of the proposals we've seen so far fall basically into three categories, one of which is just set a schedule. We're going to increase the block size according to this curve, and that's just what's going to happen. The other ones are basically two forms of miner voting. The schedule falls apart basically because we can agree that 1 megabyte is too small, but I don't have a crystal ball. No one here has a crystal ball. We have no idea what the future is going to bring 2 years out, let alone 5 years, 10 years, or 20 years. So there's not going to be a one-size-fits-all perfect solution that we can create now. That is going to be, maybe in 5 years we'll know, but right now we don't. But the miner voting proposals also are, in my view, flawed in a couple of ways. For example, if it is the case that we've seen some proposals that Jeff went over, the block size automatically increases, I believe BIP 105 version 1 is this, where the miners vote to increase a block size, and just by some average of the last number of blocks, it goes up or down. Based on the block size. But of course, that's defeated because the miners can just fill up the blocks with random garbage and the consensus rules can't tell the difference. At the other side, there's things like BIP 100 where there is a vote up or down on whether or not the block size should increase, and it's just miners making the choice. There's two problems with that. First is we've seen through selfish mining that in adversarial situations, even if your limit is 80% of the miners have to vote to increase the block size, that's really a limit of 30% because 30% of the miners can censor other miners and make it look as if 80% of the miners were voting for an increased block size. So a small, like 33% cabal being able to pick the block size is almost certainly too low of a threshold. So it doesn't really matter whether, 75%, 80%, what the threshold is, it's going to be 33, and that's too low. And the other problem is, frankly, we've seen from the conversations with miners here in the last 2 days that they don't want to be setting values any more than the Bitcoin Core developers do. They don't see it as their role. They don't see themselves as being the most informed and the most the proper people to be making this decision. And it's a fair criticism that this should be something done by the users. If the entire Bitcoin community wants us to increase the block size, we should increase it. But how do we measure that? So the solution is, since the only thing available to us is ultimately miner votes, we make the miner votes dependent on user fees, or really any mechanism the users have to control or signal to the miners in a way that incentivizes them to comply with user demands. So some of this is repeat, but the last one is important. We'd have scarce resources available, namely hash power and block reward, and a somewhat more obscure one called Bitcoin Days Destroyed, which are scarce resources the blockchain protects as being available for signaling intent. And so we have basically just these mechanisms to play with. I mean, it'd be nice if we said one user, one vote, but there's no identity on the blockchain. We can't protect against someone pretending to be a million different users. Likewise, it would be nice if we said one Bitcoin, one vote, but then a miner could potentially, or anyone, could just send the same Bitcoin around over and over and over again and get tons of different votes. So that's why these resources are the only things that are only truly limited and what we have to play with. So the proposal itself is quite simple. To increase the block, a miner is allowed to generate a larger block by deferring some subsidy, some block reward, choosing to not claim the full amount that there is allocated to them. So for example, there's a 25 Bitcoin block reward right now. A miner can choose to take only 20 or 22 or something like that. And as a result, they are allowed to create a larger block. Now, why would a miner ever want to do that? Why would they want to give up income? They would do so if the fee market provided more income in that marginal space than they were giving up as subsidy. So this ties increases and decreases in block size directly to the feed market. And then periodically, of course, like say every time the difficulty adjusts, you would also look backwards and say, okay, over this period, did blocks go up or go down, and take the average, and that would become the new base block size for the next period. There is one problem here, which is how do you set, what's the price for the fee market? You know, we've so far punted on that, and I'll get to that in a moment. But there is a parameter that can be chosen, and we can get users to decide whether that parameter is too high or too low based on voting in the transactions that they create. And I don't want to steal any credit for this. This is a derivative of two separate proposals from Minnie Rosenfeld and Greg Maxwell separately that have kind of been mixed together. And the voting scheme that I'm going to describe was a modification by Peter Todd of something originally proposed by Jeff Garzik. So here's a graph before I get to the code that actually defines this of how a miner can increase the block size. What you're seeing on the vertical axis is a increase or decrease of up to 20% in block size. And on the horizontal axis, ignore the numbers for a moment, is how much subsidy or block reward that they're giving up or claiming from previously given up in order to create a larger or smaller block. It's nonlinear, and the properties are such that at the zero point in the middle, which is to say the base block limit, the marginal cost of increasing is approximately such that when fees equal subsidy, which is to say when the fee market starts to dominate, is when you'll see increases up or down. However, that is configurable with a parameter I'll get into in a moment. And it's a nonlinear function that becomes more costly to increase the block size the larger you increase. And that has a couple of desirable properties, one of which is by looking back historically and seeing by what percent, was it 1%, 2%, 5%, you can actually get insight into what the mempool was at the time, because that tells you how much extra transactions were available at that marginal rate, which is pretty cool to have that kind of insight. It's actually something we might be able to make use of in the future. So getting a little bit into the code, it's all written. There's a GitHub link at the bottom, which I forgot to push to, but by the end of today, there will be code there. The consensus code has been written to be acceptable to Bitcoin Core, and it's all integer math, and it's fast integer math, and there's no floating point involved in the square roots or anything like that. The constant factor for this function that was chosen was explicitly done so that the cost would range from when whatever the cost is to increase a kilobyte at the midpoint, it would be four times that cost at the extreme. So if you want to increase to a full amount allowed in a burst capacity for a block, that would be a case when the mempools are, the fees in the mempools are increasing by four times their normal amount. And these were somewhat arbitrary arbitrary numbers. There was a little bit of simulation done in picking them, which unfortunately due to time constraints I will not be able to go into, but I'd be happy to talk about afterwards with individuals. But certainly there's room for bike shedding over these exact parameter choices. But one thing we don't want to set from the get-go is the security parameter. This is what determines, if I go back a couple of slides, the numbers at the bottom there is how much block reward you're giving up or claiming in order to increase or decrease the block size. That's something that's supposed to be adjustable, and it shouldn't be something that is set by fiat by the core developers, shouldn't be set by miner vote, it should be set by the users. And that value determines at what point, at what fee value, does the block size start to increase. And also, in the steady state case, if you assume a certain fee value, it determines what block size you're going to level out at. And so we want some way in which we can get users to signal whether they think that this value, which is to say the steady state block size, should go up or should go down. And since we don't have too many variables to play with, the one that seems to reflect the stakeholders best is Bitcoin days destroyed, which is a somewhat obscure value, but it is essentially if you have inputs coming in to a transaction, the age of those inputs times the value of those inputs is the Bitcoin days destroyed. So you're waiting a vote based on how much Bitcoin that person has and how long that they've been holding it. And this is something that you can't, it's ungameable. And so the proposal is that you would adjust the security parameter up or down based on the weighted votes by Bitcoin days destroyed. And the colors, thankfully, is showing up there, not on my computer. But we use two bits from the in-sequence field of the inputs in order to signal an up or down vote. And two bits are used because currently the sequence field is used for only two purposes. One is to signal that the transaction is final by setting it all to ones. And the other one is to sometime soon use it as a relative lock time, which happens to set these bits to zero. So both of those we take, since they're already existent meanings, we take them to mean that no vote. If you alternate the bit values of either of these, you can vote up or you can vote down. And then over a period, which probably would be more than 2 weeks because of variance, you'd maybe probably want closer to like once a quarter, you would look back over the last window weighted by Bitcoin days destroyed and then take that as a factor of how much total Bitcoin was transacted and decide, okay, are the users voting up or are they voting down? And therefore adjust the parameter that ultimately decides block size. Future work, the exact adjustment formula for that last parameter still needs some simulation. And I would very much like, I have code written, I'd very much like to back test it against the corpus that Rusty put together. It requires, you know, pretending that the subsidy is a little bit lower for it to make any sense, but with the mempool information, we should get some actual real idea of how that works. And there should be a draft BIP and actual deployment code written during the sprint in the next couple of days. So I encourage you to find me. And I've purposely left extra time available for questions.
Okay, thank you. First questions over here to the left.
Can transaction be censored by miners when users trying to vote?
Yes. So if there is a cabal of miners operating that does not like a vote, there could be a price differential in the fee that they pay. It's entirely possible, yes. But they do so at an opportunity cost because they're giving up the fees that they would collect. But yeah, that's a risk. But you know, it may end up being that if you're voting against what a cabal of miners want, then you have to pay a little bit extra fee for it. It's unfortunate, but I don't know a way around that.
Thank you.
Over here. Walk me through this again. Why does deferring reward and claiming earlier reward incentivize miners to reflect user preferences?
The idea is that we want the blocks, if there's so much demand for larger blocks that users are willing to pay the fees greater than the subsidy that the miner would be giving up, then we might as well just say, okay, we'll go with that. I mean, there's so much demand for it. Hopefully, we're assuming that there won't be so much demand that we enter into a suicide pact where we just pay for larger blocks and destroy Bitcoin. And for that reason, the cost, you know, the security parameter has to be high enough that it would not cause blocks to truly just increase and increase and increase. But to answer your direct question, the reason why that they are incentivized to go along with users is because the rewards that they are getting from these fees are comparable with the subsidy that they're receiving. So if they went against the user majority, they could not include, they would not be including these transactions, and therefore not collecting the fees.
Okay, go ahead.
So I have two questions for you, but I'm only gonna ask one. I'm not sure which one to ask, so can you pick a number between 0 and 1?
0.7.
Okay, so in that case, There's a way that we might be able to achieve consensus or achieve voting from stakeholders, from Bitcoin holders, without running into the problem with sending money around is to pick a block height and use Bitcoin signatures based on the private key address, or based on the, using the private key at that block height, and then weighting the votes that way. Can you comment on that? Do you think that's a good idea?
So, I mean, that's what you've described effectively as proof of stake. And excuse me. On my list of things earlier that were included as potential things we could use, proof of stake is included as a possible option. It has a weird incentive when you're thinking about deep reorgs, because if coins are very actively moving around, you can get access to a private key of coins that no longer exist like 5 blocks back, and then if it's a lot of coins, you could use that to change the block size such that it would, you know, invalidate a different fork. So it has some weird things that need to be thought out. Maybe that's not an issue, maybe it is.
Just a longer time, there's a 100 block or 1,000 block
delay between the So he's saying maybe over a longer time, like 1,000 block delay or so. And then I start worrying about if users are voting based on coins they're no longer holding, I'm worrying that, you know, there might be a situation where it no longer reflects current thought.
It could also be a block height that's in the future, so people know that there's a vote coming up, and they have to acquire coins for the vote if they want to vote in it.
It's possible, yeah, that's a possibility.
Question from IRC, do you see this being implemented with or without a hard cap, i.e. will the wiggle room not have a hard ceiling on it?
There absolutely has to be a hard limit on the block size. And actually this intersects with the next talk, which is about getting rid of block size as what we're talking about, but even if we were to do that, and you'll see in a moment about that talk, we'd still have to have a hard limit on the actual block size, just for engineering reasons. I mean, we need to make sure that we don't have buffer overflows and that our networks are able to handle certain size blocks. But conceivably with this proposal, if the security parameter is high enough, you could have a very high limit that is potentially beyond what we think is safe at this time, and just fully expect that you would never hit it until the future, you know, some point in the future that we just don't know whether that would be an acceptable limit or not.
好的，我觉得那个用这个币天毁币天，然后呢来在序列号里面进行投票，那这个很好，让普通用户也有参与的余地。但是呢，有个问题的就是说，第一个会造成那个币多的人，他币天毁的多，他是不是那个更有投票权了？这是第一个问题啊。然后第二个问题呢，建议呢就是说在投票的时候，那个交易里面要拿出一部分的钱给矿工。
是吧？就每一票都要有钱拿出来投票，这样的话给矿工可能会更合适。I
like your proposal. In your proposal, does that mean people who own a lot of Bitcoin will have advantages in votes?
Yes, and furthermore, people who've held Bitcoin for a longer period of time would have more of an advantage.
所以第一个问题你是听到就有更多的币人，有币多的人他们是有优势的。And he has another suggestion is that how about in the because you use Bitcoin Detroit per day for the votes, how about giving the miners some compositions in those transactions?
So if I interpret the question correctly, giving the miners like a certain percentage of the vote or so, or?
Yeah, so a certain percentage for as payments for their works for the votes.
Right. Well, I mean, they are, so the miners, in a sense, by reflecting the vote accurately, in order to reflect the vote accurately, they include all transactions they hear about that are above whatever their cutoff fee threshold is. And so they receive the maximum reward by not censoring transactions. It is possible that we could also add in a weighting factor by minor vote if that was desired. I was operating under the assumption that miners didn't want to be involved, but if they did, you know, we could work through that.
We have a question over here.
This is kind of a comment to all the speakers in this section. There's no right side, there's no right answer to the size of the block. It doesn't solve the fundamental problem. So there does seem to be a solution to the fundamental problem, and that's getting rid of orphans. So I kind of see all of the block size proposals as stopgap solutions. As such, the simplest proposal is probably the best one. Would you care to comment on that?
The simplest proposal being the best one, meaning that we should adopt whatever is most straightforward. I'm very deeply concerned about entities acting as what Jeff Garzik was calling the Federal Open Market Committee. People picking numbers out of a hat to decide, you know, what level of decentralization is good, or what fees need to be included in a transaction for it to be accepted in a block. Bitcoin very much is meant to be a system that's lacking those centralized controls. And so I'm very much looking for solutions that in some way tie the block size solution to in some way measurement of user demand in a way that's decentralized, that doesn't have someone setting some parameter somewhere. And so, yes, I agree, we should have the simplest possible solution, if nothing else, because this is consensus code. We don't want to screw it up. But at the same time, I think that there is great risk to a proposal that is simply just setting a number, or which is a very simple vote that is easily gamed by a miner.
Can you just speak closer to the microphone, please?
Is that better?
Yes.
Your proposal recalculate block size after 2016 blocks. What about transaction peak at example Black Friday? Visa payment system have about 20% increase volume in these days.
Yeah, well, quite coincidentally, my proposal has a maximum increase of 20% per block if there is sufficient fee demand. It assumes wallets that are configured to automatically use tools such as replace by fee in order to update the fees available in response to there being large mempools, for example. So presumably, as the blocks get temporarily full, then there would be burst capacity. As blocks get temporarily full, there would be people upping their fees to be included in the blocks, and that upped fee would then trigger burstable large blocks. But not.
Yeah. Did you do any test modeling that, in the case that large miners did want to try and grow the blocks in order to push smaller miners out, how much it would cost them?
Yeah. So it really depends on what you set that initial parameter to. Right now, the ideal parameter should be set to be approximately equal to subsidy, which is to say that you're trading a significant fraction of subsidy in order to increase the block size. And obviously, with current subsidy levels, that's orders of magnitude increase in fees over what we have right now. Or alternatively, you start by boosting the block size by an order of magnitude, which is also not something we can do. So what will have to happen is ultimately, for the foreseeable future, if this was deployed soon, you'd have to have a much smaller parameter, which means that you'd have a lot more variance in block size, and fees would not... Fees would go in and out of phase of having an effect on block size. Sometimes they would, sometimes they wouldn't. So to answer your question, finally, did I do simulations? Yes, I did some simulations, but it's necessarily not exactly with current block size data. In part because the transactions which are actually included in blocks right now, they don't really respond to mempool dynamics in terms of increasing and decreasing fees, so you don't really get an accurate representation of that. And also because the actual data in terms of the size of fees is not reflective. So this is assuming that that fees constitute a larger percent of miner income than they do right now.
When are you pushing your code?
Today. I meant to have it before I came up here.
Okay, put it together.
Okay, our next speaker is Jonas Nick, and it's validation cost metric.
Okay, I'm going to present an approach to cost metrics that we developed with Greg Sanders, who's unfortunately not here today, and Mark Friedenbach. So we heard about several block size proposals earlier, and the idea behind them is that you can increase the transaction throughput because as technological progress increases, the cost for running a full node stays actually constant. However, there are more costs than only a block size or the bandwidth that a node has to bear. And for example, there is a validation cost, just CPU time. There's also the cost to maintain a UTXO set. And actually, that means that the block size correlates with resource usage only in the typical case. So the primary example to show this is ObjectSig. And there you see that there's actually a non-linear relationship between block size and validation cost. So if you create a block that evaluates really a lot of ObjectSigs, as much as possible, you can create a block that takes longer than 10 minutes to validate, at least on my machine. And this is because the checksig opcode hashes the whole transaction and then checks the signature verification. These are both relatively costly operations. So how that means that every block size proposal has to have a strategy to deal with these kinds of non-linearities. And the simplest way how to deal with this would be introducing hard limits. And this is actually done in the implementation of BIP 101. But there are several problems with hard limits. So for example, there's no really intuitive way for choosing them. And maybe there are also other factors influencing, or not maybe, there are other factors influencing validation costs, and you really want to reason holistically about all costs. And also it really ignores the relationship between the factors. But there is a relationship because factors, meaning signature hashing, verification, and so on, they influence the cost of a full node. So this brings us to the idea of a cost metric, and this means that we want to have a function from block features to cost. So for example, the cost of a block is a weighted sum of the size of the block, the validation cost, and the UTXO growth that comes from this block. And when we have found such a function or agreed on such a function, we would get rid of a block size limit or maybe still have it, but we would introduce a new consensus rule which says that the cost of a block has to be below a certain threshold. One aspect of the costs of a node are validation costs. And in our approach, we say that the validation costs are how long it takes to validate a block on some reference machine using the current Bitcoin core code. So in order to find a validation cost function, we first start out with the model function, which for us really consists of several block features, which are weighted using coefficients and then summed up. And now the question is, how do we get these coefficients? We re-index the whole blockchain We gather data about block features and also the time it takes to validate the block, and then we can estimate those coefficients using linear regression. This is, so for example, on the right you see a one-dimensional case, on the x-axis you see the number of bytes that are hashed, and on the y-axis you see the validation time. Each point corresponds to a block, and basically the line would be our estimated coefficient. So what did we, what features did we record from a block? So the checksig operations are the most costly ones, so we included that, but we also looked at the number of bytes that were hashed. We looked at the number of bytes written and removed from the stack. So right now, Bitcoin Core already counts the number of objects, but it only counts how many are in a block, but not how many are really executed. And there's a huge difference in that. So we changed the code, and later I'll give you a link for if you want to do some benchmarks yourself. And of course, we also recorded the actual validation time of a block, which is the connect block duration, on a reference machine. And our reference machine is just my laptop with two 3 gigahertz cores. As data, we re-indexed the main chain, the test chain, and we had some custom chains which included hard to validate blocks. And we used the most recent Bitcoin Core software, but with libsecp validation. And also we had to choose some parameters, like for example, the size of the memory cache. And we set this to 3000 because I figured out that I could still comfortably work on my computer with only 5 gigabytes of RAM. So when you estimate those coefficients, you get some interesting results. For example, that each kilobyte of signature hashing adds 0.005 milliseconds to the validation time, and each signature verification adds 0.1 millisecond. The other factors that we recorded, they did not have a big impact at the moment, but they could have in the future. For example, if you create a block with a lot of hash opcodes, you can have a block that takes like 5 seconds to validate on my machine. Our fit, our function fit to the data was relatively accurate, so there was an absolute average error on test and mainnet of less than 4 milliseconds. But most importantly, the adversarial cases, so here these are hard to validate blocks, they were predicted very accurately. So now we show that the finding a validation cost function is straightforward. But we also want to have a full cost metric. So first, now with this validation cost metric, we could introduce a threshold, and we should, because we don't want to allow blocks that take really a long time to validate. But it's not so straightforward to find another threshold, because there's no one-size-fits-all solution. You don't want to constrain potential future use cases, but you also don't want to sum up the worst cases. So what you could try to do, you could try to relate the block size and validation costs, and then pick a threshold. And this is really the idea behind a cost metric. But then you have to ask yourself, how exactly do I convert these different requirements to a total cost? Is it reasonable to trade off 1 second of validation cost with 1 second of network latency? Is it possible to get this whole thing future-proof? How do we get the UTXO size in there? And I think there's no single correct answer to this problem. So what we are instead doing here is we are building on existing block size proposals and try to improve them. So Most block size proposals only consider average case use at the maximum block size. So it would seem reasonable to restrict the validation cost of a maximum size block to an average cost. And we